Methodist Women's Sunday. Once a year we get to take over, so today is the day. Tom is still here. He's sitting in the back there, so he doesn't get away, but he's here. There are many announcements contained in your bulletin. However, I'd like to call attention to a few specific ones. Vacation Bible School starts today. The golf outing is next Sunday. Now, you don't have to be a good golfer to participate in this golf outing. We take anybody, so come on and join us. It's a lot of fun. And the sign-up sheet is down the hall by Diane's office. And if you have any questions, Liz Simmons is sitting over there, so you can always talk to her. Today, or August 4th at 7 p.m., the book club will be meeting. August 6th at 11:30, the ladies who lunch are getting together. August 18th at 10 o'clock is a new member class. August 25th is new member Sunday. I also want to call your attention to the bulletin on the odds and ends point. The last thing is for the mission committee, and they are collecting school supplies, so they want you to make sure that you bring something in for that. Jim White. Supposed to have been changed. Yeah.
You lied to me. Hello. It's now on again. Welcome to Women's Sunday. I'm here to talk to you about Young at Heart. There's two events coming up, and they're both in the newsletter, which is on the back table back there. The first one is Wednesday, August 14th at 12 o'clock. It's our 13th annual bocce tournament. Anyone can play bocce with us. Last year's champs are sitting right over here in the corner, Chloe and Ralph Nash. So I'd like to see some competitors for them. That's on the 14th, okay? Now, on the 24th of August, this is not only just a Young at Heart event, it's open to anyone and everyone. It's a rodeo, okay? And it's for everyone. There's a kids program called Mutton Busting, and then there's something for the ladies. They're professional racers around the barrels. And then the real event comes on when it's the bull riding. And there's music in between, and there's food all over the grounds. And so we went there a couple years ago, and it's a fantastic event, and I think everyone would enjoy it. So if you'd like to talk to me about that later, it would be great. Thanks. I won't touch it.
Okay, there's one correction in the bulletin. After the call to worship will be the hymn 4:30 and then the opening prayer. This morning, we're pleased to have with us Sharon Spieth as our speaker, and I'll give you a little more information about her later, but I'd certainly like to welcome her this morning. Okay, I'll give you an opportunity to greet each other.
Please stand as you are able and join in the call to worship. Let us act justly. Let us love tenderly. Let us walk humbly in the path of our God. May we see Christ in one another, that we may be healers and peacemakers in Christ's name. If you will remain standing, we will now sing hymn 430. O Master, let me walk with thee. Let us now join in the unison opening prayer. Generous and gracious God, we humbly seek your grace and power so we can be your people at work in the world. Let us bring healing where there is hurting, feasting where there is famine, tranquility where there is turmoil, and welcome where there is wandering. Make our spirits willing, our arms strong, and our hearts generous today and throughout all our days. Amen. You may be seated.
There are many folks listed on the prayer list. And also, I'd like to raise up Lisa Lett is going in for tests on Monday. And next Friday evening, Pastor Tom is going to be hosting the Leisure United Methodist group, who's traveling to Vermont, and they're from Kenosha, Wisconsin, and he's hosting them at his house that evening. So, and also we would like to ask for traveling mercies on their way to Vermont. Are there any other prayer requests?
I would just like prayers for my son, Michael, who's leaving today to go on a personal journey for about a year.
Are there any others? Not? Let us go to God in prayer. Lord, this morning we pray for women everywhere. We pray for those who suffer due to unemployment, insufficient housing, and poor health care. Heal these women, Lord, African American, white Hispanic, and third world country women, as they often experience mistreatment and witness the harsh abuse of their children. We pray for women in violent crimes, human trafficking that women and children of all ages face today. We pray that the United Methodist women are there and will be there with arms outstretched in love. We pray this morning for all those lifted up in silent prayer, and especially for Herb, Georgia, Marilyn, Karen, Matt, Ruth, Diane, Jean, Zach, Chris, Amy, Ruth, Jim, Henry, Bob, and Ann, Shirley, the family and friends of Jeffrey Foster, the family and friends of Margaret Schrade, and for Michael. We also pray for the mission group from Kenosha, Wisconsin, and we pray for Lisa Lett. We also pray for those in our armed services, Kimberly, John, David, Scott, Natalia, Joshua, John, Kyle, Catherine, Paul, Jeremy, Andrew, Robert, Jerry, Kyle. On this United Methodist Women's Sunday, we come in thankfulness for the lives of United Methodist women as sisters in service who have served you and the causes of women, children, and youth throughout the world. We ask that you bless the work of these women and enrich the whole body of Fields Church. And so we now come to you saying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from Romans chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. And you may follow along on page 1123 of the Pew Bibles. In his letter to the Romans, Paul compares Christians to the human body. There are many members and each has a different function, but all are needed. Paul's concept of Christian unity is that only in Jesus Christ is unity possible. Special gifts of grace are given by God to meet the needs of the body. Now I read from Romans. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to this faith. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. And now we'll have the ushers come forward to gather our tithes and offerings.
O Lord, in response to your great love for us in Jesus Christ, we bring our offerings. Receive our gifts, bless and multiply them so that, through the love of Christ, we may reach new generations with the gospel. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. You may be seated.
Ladies that are coming on up here, they took time out of their Wednesday, completely volunteer, and you're going to hear they do an amazing job today singing our anthem. With that too, Evelyn over here, she's been so wonderful. She's filling in for Judy last week she did, and this week is her last week. So on your way out, she's doing a really great job, a great musician. Say hey to her because she's really nice.
Thank you.
Would the children please come forward? Hi, come on. How are you today? Well, today our Bible reading was talking about a lot of people being in church and how they're all different and how they all have different talents or skills. They're kind of like one of these quilts here. Now, you know what a quilt is?
A blanket,
that's right. Now, some quilts are very small and you hang them on the wall. A big, huge strawberry one, isn't that nice? Flower, okay, and it's on your bed. Yes, quilts have many uses, just like all our people here, they're all different. Now, today we're celebrating the women of the church, and they have a lot of talent. And do you know, a group of these women here made this quilt, and they made it especially to put in the room down there so that it would make it prettier, make the whole church prettier. Now you are the young people of the church, and you can do a lot of things too. You acolyte, and I bet you sing. Were you an angel? Oh, you like doing karate. Well, maybe we'll find a use for that, okay? I could use a little help. Now, sometimes we sing a song in church, and it says, I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. And today, I'm going to give you a little piece of a quilt to wear. And if somebody asks you what that means, you can tell them it means I am the church. Okay? You want purple?
I like purple.
Okay, there you go. Now let's say a prayer. Okay? We want to thank you, God, for all the women and children who help us in the church. We thank you for the privilege and strength of being able to help. Amen. Thank you. You can go now.
Thank you.
The gospel reading this morning is from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42, and you may find this on page 1028 and 29 of the Pew Bible. This passage tells about when Jesus first meets Martha and Mary, the sisters of Lazarus. They are best known for their hospitality of love of Jesus and the disciples. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all of the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." This is the good news from God.
As I mentioned before, we're pleased to have Sharon with us this morning. I'll just give you a little bit of background on Sharon. She grew up in a United Methodist minister's family and met her husband, Kent, in college. She taught social studies at the junior high level for 3 years in the Elyria Schools. While her children were young, she taught Sunday school and was the Sunday School Superintendent at Lake Shore United Methodist Church. Before retiring, she served 18 years as Christian Ed Director at Lakewood United Methodist Church, and before that, 12 years right here at Fields as our Christian Ed Director. She has been a member of the Board of Discipleship, member of the Adult Family Council of the General Board of Discipleship, co-chair of the Adult Family Council at Annual Conference, chairperson of the Board of Discipleship and Council of Ministries chairperson for the Norwalk District. She has been elected to General Conference twice and elected to Jurisdictional Conference 3 times. She has written several articles on Leisure Ministries for magazines that come out of Nashville. During her years on the Cleveland District, she helped build 10-plus homes for Habitat for Humanity and was on the steering committee and editor of the monthly United Methodist newsletter called The Carpenter's Square. She has also chaired the Leadership Academy. Sharon.
If I were looking for a church, I'd come to this service. I'd come to this church. It is great to be here and see familiar faces and also those of you that I've not met before. Those were good times with Jim Skinner and Lou Deal. I still work with Jim on a conference committee. And we, quite often, we're talking about somebody from Fields Church. So thank you for asking me to come. It's great to be here. I realize that the scripture was just read for you, but we have two scripture passages we're asked to look at this morning. The first is from Romans, and just bear with me because I don't know whether you listen to scripture like I do, but it's kind of like, oh, which one are they talking about? You know, I need to have it read to me and then whatever you're going to say about it. So just bear with me while I read it. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we who are many, one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. And the gift I really want to talk about this morning, just give some illustrations about, have to do with encouragement, because I could, those of you that came up and welcomed me this morning, I could remember moments when, or conversations we had when you were encouraging to me, and hopefully I was encouraging to you. Though I would have to tell you that when Ralph Nash's name was mentioned, what I remember is that Ralph Nash got me to climb that flagpole out there, and after the fact I'm going, that was not smart. That was not smart to do that. And he encouraged me to do it. But anyway, the part of the scripture that speaks to me is we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. And I want to talk about, just briefly, about Warren McDonald. You don't know him, I don't know him, except that Regina Brett, who is a columnist for the Plain Dealer, wrote about him several weeks ago. He's a double amputee. And he gives motivational talks, goes around and inspires persons. He is a hiker, and he was hiking in Australia. And some of you have probably read this article. Anyway, a boulder, a 2,000-pound boulder, fell on his legs. And there was another hiker with him, and the hiker went to get help. And it took 45 hours for them to get back to him. So when the doctor talked to him about what he needed to do, he said, "We are going to need to amputate your legs." And Warren McDonald said, "Well, where are you going to amputate? You know, what? How much are you going to take?" And he said, "Well, I need to take above the knees." And this threw him, appropriately so, into a deep depression, because hiking had been a large part of his life. And he said that, and the article did not indicate how long he had been in the depression, but he said one day he thought, you know, am I just going to wallow in this depression, or am I going to see this as a challenge? And he said somehow that flipped a switch in his head, and it was kind of like, oh, yeah, that's how I'm going to see this. And the quote they give that Warren McDonald said was, "The sheer adventure of it was beyond the fear." As a result of that, he learned to climb again. He ended up climbing the Tasmania Cradle Mountain, the Cradle Mountain in Tasmania, and went on to climb Mount Kilimanjaro. And what he says is that everything life hands you is your next big adventure. So I never met Warren McDonald, but that article stuck with me, and I'm one of these people, I'll say to my husband, put that piece of paper over there, I want to keep that article. So I pulled that out, remembering that. But there are, actually I was only going to give you one other illustration, but I'm going to give you two. The second one has to do with my mother. My mother was over 80 when she died. They lived at Lakeside, and my mother had been a public school teacher, public school English teacher. And one of the communities where she taught was Napoleon, Ohio. And it's a small community on the west side of the state. And when she died, we decided that what we would do is to put the obituary notice in the Napoleon newspaper, thinking there might be somebody who would remember Mildred Child. So we had the memorial service at the Lakeside Church. And during the service, Floyd Foat was the United Methodist pastor doing the service. He said, "Is there anyone who would like to say something about Mildred Child?" And this woman in the back of the church that none of us recognized raised her hand, and she said, told her name and said, "I was so happy that you put that obituary notice in the Napoleon paper. I saw that and was so glad that the service had not been held yet, because I wanted to be here to talk about Mildred Childs. And she said, when I was in high school, whatever had happened in her life, she was depressed, discouraged, etc. And she said, your mother was coming down the steps after school, and I went over and said to her, Mrs. Childs, I'd like to talk to you. And she said, my mother said, oh, let's just sit here on the steps right here and talk. And she said, she did not indicate what my mother had said, but she said, that changed. That changed the way I looked at things. And I guess the reason I give that illustration, because I am absolutely confident that those of you in this congregation have done the very same thing. Now, what is an absolute hoot is that yesterday I was at the Landmark Hardware in Bay Village buying dog food, and if you buy 12 bags of dog food, they give you a free bag. So they said, could you give us your name? And I said, Sharon Spieth, last name spelled S-P-I-E-T-H. So one of the workers at this Landmark Hardware said, you know, I had a guidance counselor named Spieth. And I said, oh, really? Where did you live? He said, in Avon Lake. I said, that's my husband. He goes, oh, really? I said, yeah. I said, he's out in the car right now. He's got a broken bone in his foot, and that's the reason he was staying in the car. So he went out and said to my husband, you know what? I spent a lot of time in the guidance office, and Kent did not remember Charlie Smith. But Charlie said, I spent a lot of time in the guidance office, and you said to me, you know, I think what would be a good idea would be if you would go into the armed services. And he said, I did that, and that turned out to be one of the best things that I've ever done. So I guess, as I said before, I absolutely know that all of you have received that kind of encouragement. You have used the gift that you've been given, and you have done that also for others. So those are kind of, you know, I realize those are kind of homemade illustrations, but I guess it's to for all of us to recognize that we do that all the time. Now, the second scripture that you were asked to listen to, and again, I wish to read it. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her door to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Now, doesn't that sound like a church statement? Tell them to help me. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. Now, the material that Jan gave me suggests that Mary gives her full attention to Jesus and is not distracted by worldly things. But the material went on to say that Mary types are not just hearers. They are doers also. Now, the Martha types say they believe, but they are too caught up in worldly things to have time to grow in Christ. And I would say, just recognizing who I am, I'm a doer. I've been a doer since I was like about that big. So I need a discipline to follow, and I personally use the upper room on a daily basis. My Bible and the upper room are in the bedroom, and I read it right before I go to sleep. Some of the meditations or stories are very inspirational. God does wonderful things in people's lives quite often. After I've read whatever is the meditation, even though it's just a printed word, my eyes tear up. It's kind of like God just does wonderful things in situations that I would think would absolutely finish people off. Anyway, I think most of us here are combinations of the Mary Martha, depending on what's happening in our lives. But I want to add an additional scripture today, and I'll use a paraphrase. Dick Parks is the last senior pastor I worked with at Lakewood. He sent me a sermon that he recently preached. The following is a quote from the sermon, and this is a paraphrase. You'll recognize the scripture. This is Dick Parks talking. It seems to me that Jesus is pretty clear about what he expects from me, because he was a preacher, as far as preaching concerns. Now, this is a paraphrase. He wants me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind. He wants me to set at liberty those who are oppressed and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. In fact, he asks that of all of us. Dick saying, he asks it of me, and he also asks it of each of us here this morning. I grew up in a home where a social conscience was valued and practiced. As I was putting this message together, I was remembering a time when that was tested in high school. In my group of friends, there were three persons that were probably different now that I look back on it. Marty Lehman was our class president, smartest kid in our class, and very popular with all of us. He was Jewish, though I never even knew it. I mean, to show how clueless I was in high school, I'm sure there was a synagogue in Portsmouth, and my dad was a district superintendent in Portsmouth. But I have no clue where it was, and didn't even recognize that Marty Lehman was Jewish. Okay, it was never an issue. Kurt Gentry was an outstanding student, good basketball player, he was black. Bob Chen belonged to another Methodist church, attended the district youth meetings, and was a close friend. His parents were Chinese. Now you need to put this illustration, this story I'm going to tell you in this context. I graduated from high school in 1959. So flip back to that. Kurt Gentry asked me to attend one of the big dances. I said yes. Several days later, the dean of women, and this was an extremely large high school, so they had a dean of women, called me into her office and talked to me something about appropriateness. It was kind of like, what is she saying? I don't even, what is it? I knew it didn't feel right, but I couldn't figure out what seemed wacky to me. I wasn't even clear at first what she was trying to say. By the time I got home, I was hopping mad. Skin color had never been an issue in our family. Now, I hadn't thought about this situation for years until I started thinking about this message. By the way, I went to the dance with Kurt Gentry. That triggered me thinking about a community, and this was another situation, that had a rental property available. A black couple we knew wanted to rent the house. When the community dragged its feet regarding renting to them, my husband and I worked with others We had met through American Field Service. We were very active in the foreign student program. And contacted an American civil liberties lawyer to encourage and actually to help the city do the right thing. Eventually, they rented the house to the young couple. Now, I suspect most of you can remember ordinary times over the years when you have preached good news to the poor, proclaimed release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, set at liberty those who are oppressed, proclaimed the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, it is obviously easier to have a social conscience when it is nurtured and modeled in the home in your formative years, which is the kind of home that I grew up in. When your church home models a social conscience with members who help with Habitat for Humanity, tutoring kids, inner city and others, distributing food at hunger centers, volunteering at Nehemiah Mission, we make the world a different place. Quoting Dick Parks again, it is not entertaining, and it's certainly not intellectually stimulating. It is simply a reminder that a social conscience matters, and the commitment to proclaim to all that those who have ears to hear is paramount. God bless you all. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord, grant what has been said with our lips, we may believe in our hearts, and what we believe in our hearts, we may practice in our lives. May we go in peace and live as one with your love and guidance through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.